Hello everyone, welcome to CHEHEL's Zoology Lectures. If you like the content of this channel, please subscribe to this channel, and for further notifications, please hit the bell icon. So today we'll discuss about ecology and evolution. Moving further, we'll talk about habitat and ecological niche today in today's lecture. What is an habit? What is a habitat? It's a specific place with particular combination of abiotic factors, that means environment, which is occupied by any organism or population or community. That means it is a physical space which is occupied by any living organism, and such kind of place will be having its own abiotic factors, set of abiotic factors. So what will be the characteristics of habitat? It is a physical place. It can be small or it can be large, small as a termite's intestine, like for Trichonympha, and as large as ocean for blue whale or sperm whale. Generally specific for animals, that means there will be some animals which will be who will be habitat specific. So habitat can be specific for certain animals but can be general for others. It is occupied by entire community. That means in a particular habitat, it is not necessary that only one living organism will reside in that habitat. There can be plenty of living organisms which are inhabiting the same area, the same locality. So such type of habitation is termed as cohabitation. Okay, so here are certain examples, like this rabbit. The habitat of this rabbit is grassland. The habitat of scolodon is ocean. The habitat of catfish is this is Velago Atu. So habitat of catfish is rivers and lakes, and habitat of Plasmodium vivax, that is a parasite, and the habitat of Plasmodium vivax can be RBC of human or Anopheles mosquito, female Anopheles mosquito. So that is the particulars about habitat. Okay, so further moving forward, there will be some organisms, as we have talked in previous slide, that that organisms will be habitat specific. Now what is habitat specificity? Animals often live in specific habitats having particular environmental conditions. Like you can see, these all are amphibians. Okay, so all amphibians, they always reside in fresh water only. There are no amphibian who are inhabitants of marine water. Not even a single amphibian species is there who lives in marine water or in ocean. So these are strictly freshwater organisms. So these are habitat specific. Similarly, this organism, that is a dinoflagellate, which is termed as Trichonympha, that will specifically live in the gut of termites and wood roaches, that is a species of cockroach which specifically feed upon woods. Okay, so this Trichonympha, it will always be found in wood roaches and termite gut. On the other hand, some organisms, they can be found in a different kind of environment. That means such organisms are more tolerant and can live in different environments with fluctuations in their salinity, suppose water salinity, or in oxygen content, like as shown here in this pic. These are larvae of Chironomus. Chironomus is an insect, in general term, which is termed as midges. Okay, so these are larvae of Chironomus, which can live equally well in water with high as well as low oxygen content. So oxygen content is not a problem or not an obligatory factor for these larvae. Similarly, there is a fish here, shown here, Hilsa hilsa, and the common name is Indian shad, and it can live in both fresh water as well as in saline water. So some organisms are habitat specific, like amphibians and this Trichonympha, while other organisms like Hilsa hilsa and the Chironomus larvae, these are not specific for their habitat. So moving further, let's remove these. Okay, moving further, we'll talk about microhabitat. Now what is microhabitat? As the name suggests, micro means very small, habitat is physical place to live. So there can be subdivisions of a habitat, having different environmental conditions and different kind of organisms. Suppose if we talk about a forest, okay, in the forest there can be two different microhabitats. One can be tree canopy, you can see that is the topmost layer of trees, topmost portion of trees, that is termed as canopy. So tree canopy can be one habitat, microhabitat in a same habitat, that is forest, and the other microhabitat can be forest floor, which can be rich in mosses, and the environmental conditions of these two microhabitats in the same habitat are different. How? Like in forest floor, there can be less sunlight, more moisture, and that's why more mosses will grow here, and similar kind of organisms which will love shady areas that will inhabit in this area. So that will be one microhabitat in a forest habitat. And the other one is canopy, which will be chiefly occupied by bird species, and canopy will be having more sunlight, more wind flows, and less moisture, so that will be inhabited by birds. Similarly, in the case of desert, again there can be different microhabitat in a same habitat. The main habitat is desert. So in desert, one can be a burrow. One can be a burrow which can be cooler inside. So the temperature of burrow can be lower than that of the surface. So that is one microhabitat in the desert. And the other is open desert, which will be hotter and arid in comparison to this burrow. So two microhabitat, they can be present in the desert habitat. Similarly, if you talk about a pond, so here is the example of pond. If you talk about pond, again there can be two different microhabitat. One can be muddy bottom, like this muddy bottom, and other can be open surface water of the pond. So both of these, they will be having different kind of environmental condition. Like muddy bottom, in muddy bottom there will be less sunlight penetrating in the benthic zone, and surface water will be having more sunlight, more oxygen content will be less in the bottom. So different kind of organism, they will inhabit these area. And this term microhabitat, it was given by Yap in 1922. So moving forward, now we'll talk about the term ecological niche. This term was given by Grinnell in 1971. What is niche? Animals' place in biotic community and its relation to its food and its enemies, that is ecological niche. In other words, you can say a species' functional role in its ecosystem is termed as ecological niche. According to Odom in 1959, Odom said that position or status of an organism within its community and ecosystem resulting from organism's structural adaptations, physiology, and behavior, that is termed as ecological niche. So basically, it includes some factors such as what an organism eats and what eats it, its range of movement, its nesting, and other requirements like mate, and its effect on other components of the community, and on physical environment, how abiotic factors will affect this organism, and how in turn this organism will affect the abiotic factors, and how it will affect other organisms which are living in the vicinity or in the same habitat. Okay, so there are different components of ecological niche which together join to form ecological niche. So these components are, first is spatial or habitat niche. Second is trophic niche, and third is multidimensional and or hypervolume niche. Now, as the name suggests, spatial or habitat niche is the actual physical space which is occupied by an organism. That is termed as spatial or habitat niche. The next is trophic niche, which will determine the trophic level of organism, whether that organism lies in first trophic level, primary or secondary, or consumers or tertiary. So that is the trophic niche. That means functional position of organism in ecosystem. That means, in literal words, this means what this organism eats and which organism eats it. Okay, that means prey and predator of that organism. Then multidimensional or hypervolume niche. As the name suggests, multidimensional, that means an hypervolume. Hyper means more than volume. Volume in itself is a three-dimensional thing. So hypervolume means more than even volume. That means it will be multidimensional. That means more than three-dimensional. Okay, so that is the position of organism in environmental gradients. That means air, water, sunlight, pressure, okay, rainfall, humidity. So all these are multidimensional or hypervolume niche factors. That means abiotic factors. Roughly you can count all abiotic factors in this multidimensional or hypervolume niche, which will be shared by several organisms of the same habitat. That means it is very much common that multidimensional or hypervolume niche of different organism can intersect with each other or can overlap with each other, in spite of the fact that those organisms can have different ecological niche. So basically, out of these three components, it is an obligation that any organism should have at least one component different for having a different ecological niche, so that ecological niche of two organisms should not overlap. So for that, two components can be same for two organisms, but one have to be different. Okay, so that means degree of freedom is here two. That means any organism can choose two things. It can choose its habitat niche or its trophic niche, suppose, but cannot choose multidimensional. Or generally it is, organism can choose its habitat niche or multidimensional niche, but cannot choose the trophic niche. Okay, so that are the difference, and these three components, they together combine to form ecological niche, term ecological niche. So I think it is clear up to now that habitat is simply a physical place where any organism resides, and ecological niche, it's all the activities it does from birth to death that fall under ecological niche, whether that is interaction with other organisms or with its environment or with its mate or with its prey or predator, anything that will fall under ecological niche. That means any activity performed by any organism is ecological niche. Okay, so here, like this is showing some examples of ecological niche. Here you can see that here is a rabbit, and this grassland is its habitat. Okay, now this is its habitat. That means it is its special or habitat niche. Okay, now this rabbit, it eats carrots, and rabbit is eaten by this fox. So these two will form its trophic niche. Okay, so these two will form its trophic niche, and grassland is its habitat niche, and this rabbit, it will dig a burrow to live in. Okay, so that means it will alter the quality and aeration properties of the soil. So that means it is affecting its abiotic environment. So that will be a part of hypervolume niche. Now the fecal matter of this rabbit, it will be eaten up by these beetles, dung beetles. So again, that is affecting the hypervolume niche. So this is a list of interactions that will be performed by this rabbit, and these all together will form the ecological niche of this rabbit. Okay, so I think now this is clear. Now move forward. We'll talk about the three components of ecological niche one by one. So first of all, we'll talk about special or habitat niche. Okay, so now, as we have already clarified, the special niche is a physical place which is inhabited by any organism. That is a special niche, possession of any physical, specific physical place by any species. Now here are some examples. Here you can see that 7 millipede species belong to same trophic level, and they inhabit the same habitat. Okay, but they also have same trophic level. That means all the seven species, six are shown here in this picture, you can see. So six millipede species are shown here. So seven millipede species, they have been found to reside in same habitat in the forest floor. And but what is the difference? They occupy different micro habitat. So you can see now the spatial or habitat niche has differed. In spite of having one common habitat, their micro habitat differs because their trophic niche is same. That means all of these are decomposers. If they will reside, if they would have reside in the same micro habitat, then there would have been competition, tough competition among these species, and only one or two must have survived. So that is an alternative for these species, that they occupy different micro habitat. Now, what are these different micro habitat? Because in a specific habitat, the hypervolume niche become common, okay, and their trophic level is also common. Trophic niche is also common. So the third portion, which is obligatory for them, is to have a different habitat, or so that's why they occupy different micro habitat. Now, one species will be found within the leaf litter. One will be beneath leaf litter, one will be superficial on logs of wood, fourth will be under the logs on ground, and fifth will be on under logs on log surface, that means on the ventral surface of the log, wood log. Another one will be beneath bark of logs, and the last one will be in heartwood of logs. Heartwood, you must have known, that is the dark colored hardwood which is present in the center of log, and the lighter portion which is surrounding the center dark portion is termed as sapwood. Sapwood is softer and hardwood is harder, I guess so. Okay, now there is another example of Hemidactylus brookii, which have again occupied different spatial or habitat niche because it also have same trophic niche. Okay, same trophic level but different habitat. Now Hemidactylus brookii that occupied houses. Hemidactylus lecholti that has occupied large trees, and Hemidactylus reticulatus it has occupied rocks. So that there shouldn't be any competition between these three species. If these would have been in the same habitat, suppose all of three would have occurred in houses, then there would have been a tough competition and only one would have survived among these three. So the best option was to exclude any kind of competition, is to alter any of the component of the ecological niche. Which are the component of ecological niche? One is habitat niche, another is trophic niche, and the third one is hypervolume niche. So organisms have to differ at least in one component among these niche component. Two can be common, but the third one should be different so that the overall ecological niche of two organisms can be different. So next we'll talk about a trophic niche. Trophic niche is again feeding habits. Okay, so may have general habitat but different feeding habits. So that is trophic niche. That means two organisms can reside in same habitat, same physical area, but they differ in their trophic levels. So one example is Darwin's finches. They all occur in Galapagos Island, same habitat, but they have different food habits. Some are feeding on leaves, some are feeding on seeds, some are feeding on grains, some are feeding on fruits. So they possess different feeding habits. That's why their trophic levels are different. So they can survive in one habitat. Another example is of these water bugs. You can see here, one is back swimmer, Notonecta, and other is water boatman or Coryxa. So both of these are aquatic bugs and they occupy the same habitat, that means pond, which is choked with small vegetation. But they both have different feeding habits. Like Notonecta, that is back swimmer, it will feed upon small animals. Okay, but like insects and tadpoles and snails and small fishes, while Coryxa, it will feed upon vegetation, specifically decaying vegetation. Okay, so that's why they can survive in one habitat because they have different feeding habits. and there will be no competition among these two species. Now, next is, here are again example of two more examples of trophic niche. Falcocorax aristotalis. This bird is surface feeder. That means it will be feeding upon the fishes which are surface swimmer. Okay, so surface swimmer fishes will be fed upon by this, and which is termed as the common name for this bird is shag. And the second bird is cormorant, that is P. carpo, and that is a bottom feeder. It will specifically feed upon the flat fishes which will reside in the floor of ocean. Okay, so it will feed upon flat fishes and bottom organisms like specifically invertebrates like shrimps. Okay, so that is a bottom feeder, and this shag is surface feeder. On surface, it will feed upon specifically on free swimming fishes and eels. So these two have different feeding habits, so there will be no competition among these two. Further, there are two species of mynna. That is weaver bird. Okay, so there are two different species of weaver bird. One is Ploschius melanocephalus. Melanocephalus, as the name suggests, melano means darker, cephalus means head, so dark head. So there, its head is black. You can see its head is black. And the other one is Ploschius collaris, that is having a collar-like structure. So now this Ploschius collaris, these two species, they will inhabit the same area. That means they will make their nest in the same locality, maybe sometime on the same tree. But still, there is no competition among these. Why? Because this melanocephalus, it will feed upon insects. So it is insectivorous, and this collaris species is, it will feed upon grains. Okay, so their feeding habits is different, and that's why there is no competition among these two. That's why they can inhabit a same locality or same area. So moving forward, we'll talk about hypervolume niche. This is a term which is given by Hutchinson. Now, hypervolume, as I have already explained, is a multidimensional space of resources in which falls abiotic factors like light, nutrient, air, water, and wind pressure, wind velocity, water pressure, moisture level. Okay, so that is available to the organism. Now you can see here, there is a crater which is created by elephants and which is filled by the rainwater. Okay. Now this is filled by rainwater, and that has created a temporary pond-like structure. So this zebras and hyenas in savanna, both would like to drink water from the same water hole created by elephants. That means this water hole is created by elephants, but both of these organisms, they will come together to this same craters, the same water hole to drink water. So water here becomes the common factor. Now water is what? This is an abiotic factor, and that is one portion of this multidimensional space of resources. So when such common environmental factors are present, hypervolume niches of two organisms will intersect in space. That means the same air is utilized by all of these three organisms, by hyenas, by elephants, and by zebra. So it will become a common factor, and that is termed as hypervolume niche, which can be essentially shared by different species, even more than two species, but still it doesn't create much competition for that if their trophic niche are different. So one niche difference is must. One component of niche must differ. Okay, now this cat, you can see here, this cat, feed upon rats near human habitation. Okay, so this is having a different ecological niche, different habitat, but same trophic niche. But this owl that lives in woodland, and it also feeds upon rats and shrews and mice. So basically the trophic level of these two organisms, cat and owl, is same, but their habitat is different. And also their activity period is different. Generally cats, they can kill its prey during day also, but owls are necessarily nocturnal. Okay, cat can be diurnal, it can kill the prey during day also. So period of activity, that also differs, and also their habitat is different. As you can see, cat is near human houses, and this owl is in the woodlands. Also, if you talk about this Arctic fox and this jackal, again, so we're talking about this Arctic fox and African jackal. These both are equivalent of each other, ecological equivalents, because both of these are scavengers and they also feed on eggs of birds. Arctic fox, it feeds upon the remains of seals, which is killed by polar bear in winter, while in summer it will feed upon the eggs of a quill moth bird. And this African jackal, it takes the eggs of ostrich and the remains of zebra, which is killed by lions. Okay, so such organisms are ecological equivalents. Equivalents means which are equal ecologically and having same trophic level or trophic niche, fall on the same trophic level but in different habitats. So moving forward, again, more explanation for ecological equivalents. These are different organisms occupying same ecological niche in different geographical areas, and these are termed as ecological equivalents. Like in grasslands of Africa, there are two examples of two habitats which are different, of course. One is grassland of Africa, and on the other hand, the second habitat is grassland of North America. Now, there is one food chain in grassland of Africa and other in grassland of North America, but ecologically these food chain are equivalents, and every organism is equivalent to other organism in the same trophic level at this different habitat. Like in grassland of Africa, grass is the primary producer, then antelope is primary consumer, and the lion is secondary consumer. That means lion will feed upon antelope and antelope will feed upon grass. Antelope is a deer species. Now in the grassland of North America, again grass is primary producer, and bison, that is you can say wild buffalo, bison, that is primary consumer, and wolf is secondary consumer. So wolf will feed upon bison and bison will feed upon grass. Now in case of grassland of Africa, hyena is scavenger and coyote is scavenger in case of North America. Giraffe is browser on leaves, that means giraffe will eat leaves in case of Africa, and deer will browse on leaves in case of North America. So these organisms are equivalents. How? Now in this food chain, this wolf is equivalent to lion of Africa, and antelope of Africa is equivalent to bison of North America. Coyote of North America is ecologically equivalent to hyena of grassland of Africa, because both of these, they share a common trophic level. Similar is the case of mountain goat. Now this mountain goat, that is Oryzomys americanus, and it is found at high altitudes in mountain area of North America. It is ecologically equivalent to Capra ibex of Alps of southern Europe. So it is found in hilly area of Europe, ibex. Okay, so both of these are ecologically equivalent. Okay, so that is the concept of ecological equivalence. I hope it is clear. Now moving forward, Gauss principle or principle of competition exclusion. A given ecological niche is occupied by a single species only. This is Gauss principle. That means no two species can occupy same ecological niche. If they occur in the same geographical area, that means if they share a common habitat, either they will use different food items, that means their trophic niche will be different, or they will be active at different times. One can be diurnal, other can be nocturnal. That means one is active during daytime and other is active during nighttime. So, or they can occupy different niches. Otherwise, one will survive and other will be excluded. That means survival of the fittest and the most competent. Only that will survive and the other will be excluded if they have common trophic niche, hypervolume niche, as well as same spatial niche or same habitat. If all the three components will be shared by two species, only one of them will survive, other will be excluded out of that environment or that habitat or that niche because of competition. Only the competent and the successful or the powerful one or the fittest one will survive. Okay, so that is Ghosh principle, that no two species can occupy same ecological niche. So there are certain examples in nature which has proven this Ghosh principle. So one such example is of American gray squirrel, you can see, and red squirrel. In the case of British Isles, a small island so that is surrounded by water. So in case of British Isles, American gray squirrel was introduced onto that ice, and that can be intentionally or accidentally, that is not known, but this American gray squirrel, it has completely replaced the native red squirrel, which was native of that Britain, that British Isles. So that was completely replaced and it is not found there anymore. So that is an example of competition exclusion, because the niche of these two species was exactly same. Their food habit was same, their habitat was same, their hypervolume niche was same. So the competent one was, the less competent one was removed and the more competent one would have survived. So similar in the case of Periplaneta americana and Blatta orientalis. In India, this Periplaneta americana, that is common cockroach which you see in your houses, that was introduced by some food ship at the port, and this has completely replaced the native cockroach of India, that is Blatta orientalis, which is black in color. You can see here, majority of you have never seen this species. That means it has completely been replaced by this Periplaneta americana because of their common ecological niche. So that's why only one species will survive if the ecological niche is same. So that is Ghosh principle. So these two examples were depicted by nature, but Ghosh has also conducted an experiment in the laboratory to prove the Ghosh principle. Now what is that? Okay, he has taken two species of Paramecium. One is Paramecium aurelia, that is shown here in this pink color, and other is Paramecium caudatum, shown here in blue color. So he has observed the culture of these two species. First, he cultured them individually into two food jars having water, and constantly he has supplied food and constantly has changed the water supply and adding the fresh water. So he has observed the separate cultures, they grow equally well. Here you can see that red line, this red S-shaped curve, growth curve, is of Paramecium aurelia, and this blue line is for Paramecium caudatum. So here you can see both of these are growing equally well in separate culture. So that is result of separate culture. So both of them are growing equally well. But when these are placed in one container, in one culture, you can see that only this red line is growing and the blue has fallen down. That means its growth has been halted and it has diminished from the culture. So it was dead. So what was this? This blue line was Paramecium caudatum. And the red line has shown the growth of Paramecium aurelia. That means Paramecium aurelia was much more successful than the Paramecium caudatum. Now, why they couldn't survive in the same culture? Because their food need were similar and they have the same environment, the same habitat, and the food was limited. So there was a tough competition for food. So finally, the competent one that has won, and that is Paramecium aurelia. So that is a laboratory example of Gauss principle or principle of competition exclusion that is performed by Gauss. Now moving. Last slide is for some interesting facts. Now, members of same species may occupy different niches during different stages of their life. Okay, so that is something quite interesting, that one organism can have different niches. Specifically, you talk about trophic niches. Okay, so the fox, you can see fox, it is chiefly carnivore, but in winter when there is no food available, it may switch to berries and grapes. Okay, so fox can eat grapes even if that are sour. So similarly, in case of frog, Rana tigrina, you can say, or any frog species, different feeding habits and life stages of frog reduces intra-specific competition because there is huge number of eggs and huge number of larva. So there can be competition for food, and which can be intra-specific. Whenever the competition is intra-specific, it is more severe. Okay, so it is a necessity that trophic level of tadpole larva and adult frog should be different. So larva is primary consumer, that means it is chiefly herbivore. It will feed upon small phytoplanktons and algae, okay, basically plant products. And the main adult, the main frog, adult frog, that is secondary consumer, that will it will feed upon insects. Okay, similar is the case with river turtle, young turtle and adult turtle. They occupy different trophic levels. They have different trophic niches. Young turtles are secondary consumers. That means young turtles are secondary consumers. So they will feed upon snails and worms and insects. Okay, and adult turtles are primary consumers. So they will feed upon the green plants like tape grass, etc. So they have different trophic niche. Thank you.